I'm Elie Seckbach, reporting.
So right now, what is your coach Jerry working on?
What?
What is Jerry working on?
Jerry is working on short punches with Hammond.
And
so all day we're going to be talking to our members about short range punches.
Why?
It's a completely different way of fighting. It's something that's a necessity to be a complete fighter. You need to have a short range punches. You have to have that short game. And the mechanics and the technique, it's completely different than the long range shots.
What's more explosive? Short range or long range where you can put everything? Or the same?
It depends on the person. It depends on the body type, right? Guy like Mike Tyson had unbelievable punches that were very short in your face. Same weight division, you got a guy like Lennox Lewis that needed a much longer distance to create his power.
So can you
or a guy like Vlad Klitschko.
On the water bag, how would you throw a short distance punch? Like Bruce Lee had the one inch punch, right?
So it's going to be very difficult for me to give it justice in a small clip, but...
Okay. Well, we have an hour and a half of tape, so you can take your time.
So here's a long range right hand. And in this technique, I step in, I rotate my hips, and I extend the fist, and I lock out my elbow, right? And if we can say that this is 100% of my extension, I can't extend my hand anymore. Where I actually land is at the 95th percentile, and then that last 5% I follow through. That places my opponent on the end of my punches. And that's where all the power is. It's on the end of the technique, the last little bit. So, like I said, this is 100%. I hit him at 95%. It's on the end of the shot. If he was this close to me, I cannot throw the same punch and just hit him at 20% and then expect that to be a powerful blow, because that is no longer on the end of that technique. Bye, good work today. So, what I need to do is I need to select a whole new punch that this now represents 100%. That is as much as this punch will ever extend. That way, when I hit him here, I'm actually hitting him on the 95th percentile of this particular shot. So let me show you this punch, shadow boxing wise, in full speed, real time. So even if I straight miss this punch, it's never gonna extend out like that because it was never designed to do so. So all of your power punches, which is every punch other than your jab, have multiple ranges, okay? David, come here. My jab, this is the only punch that I don't put my hips into, right? And it has a finite place it lands, right? Bang, bang. And it's my responsibility as a fighter to go and establish my distance for the jab. If he's too close, I'm gonna have to back off to get room for that because I can't adjust the range of this shot. Now, the right hand or any power punch, for instance, any punch that I put my hips into is different. So the right hand, I can be this far away, stand out. But like I said, I can be this close also and select a different range of punch that has just as much power. I can be a half step back from that. I can be a half step back from that. What I'm trying to get at is my power punches can be varied as far as their distance goes. The left hook, I can be very close, half step back, half step back, half step back. Back until I get to the point where the only way to hit him now would be to reach in, meaning the top of my head, the center of my hips, and the center of my feet, forming that vertical line. Once that line starts to dip forward, I am now off balance and reaching in. That means that the punch, that the target is just too far away. So, and here's a big mistake some people make. Instead of just letting this punch miss what it should, they'll try to make this punch still land by reaching out. And that actually gives my opponent a huge opportunity to hit me. So part of being a good boxer is to know when a punch should just miss, right? And I tell my fighters, don't make a punch that was supposed to miss land because you will be reaching in, okay? Back to those different ranges of my power punches, right? So I can do the same thing with the uppercut. Close, half step back, a little further, a little further. I don't wanna get too far away with the right uppercut, right? Like I said, I don't wanna end up reaching in. But my left uppercut is much more versatile because I can be as far away basically as the jab, or I can be right here on the inside and still have an effective left uppercut.
All right, there you have it. Brandon Cosell, an explanation. What do fighters use more? There's no right or wrong. I don't see a lot of fighters fighting on the inside like back in the day. Like real inside fighting.
Yeah, I think in general, boxers of this era compared to like 40s, 50s, and 60s embrace more movement and more jabbing. I think that's something you can definitely say about the modern boxer.
Hit and don't get hit.
Yeah.
Because on the inside, you're going to get hit probably.
The inside is a rough place. Even done perfectly, you come out of those fights scraped up and marked up, and you couldn't even explain why. You know, why do I have a bruise here on my bicep? Why is there a scrape on the back of my shoulder, right? Because the inside is a rough and tumble place.
What do you prefer more, fighting on the inside or outside? You personally.
I liked fighting on the inside because I was a good body puncher when I fought, and you have a lot of opportunities to go to the body when you're close.
Do you get more knockouts on the inside or outside, or the same?
Me personally, on the inside, the left hook to the body was my bread and butter punch, and I needed to be pretty close to a guy to land it.
Last question on this topic. How do you generate all that force without being able to wind into your shots and just in a short 90-degree angle?
Well, the term is differentiated rotation, right? And let's go to the left hook, for instance. In a very exaggerated way, I want you to see this technique. And notice that my hip starts its action before the rest of me. And my hip ends up pulling my fist. Again, I'm over-exaggerating this to show you this.
You did
right?
it in slow motion for
but
us.
But the hip goes in front of my fist. And then, once this is built up, all the stored energy is then released into that motion. Have we all seen like a baseball card of a pitcher, and the pitcher is like this with his arm behind him, right? What's happened is his torso got in front of the technique and he had to whip the arm behind him in order to throw the ball. Let's look at another baseball card of a big lead, of a home run hitter. And in that baseball card, he's twisted like that and that bat trails behind him. That's the same concept with that hook, is that it actually trails behind your hip. So your hip comes in front, and then comes the rest of the shot. All right, so let me throw it in real time. Those of you watching at home, if you have the availability to slow this down, what you're gonna notice is that my feet and my hips, they start rotating far before my fist moves.
Do it one more time, baby.
So I'm gonna slow it down. Hip first.
Okay, now let's move to close range, to the inside. Can you generate the same power? It's half
Check
of
this
it.
Out, watch. So, like I said, my hip shoots first, and then the fist goes, right? And what that action does is it gives me the same benefit of this. If I were to now bring my hip back with my fist, it's like I did this. It's like I went boom, but instead the hip went first. So it's the same exact power that I generate if I cock my punch, boom, but instead I use good technique and I don't open up in front of my guy, yielding the same result.
There you have it, Brandon Krause. Hope this guy helps you guys. Peace to the brand. I'm Elie Seckbach reporting. So there you have it. Another great video for ES News. For ESNewsReporting.com, I'm Elie Seckbach reporting. And you can follow me on Twitter at Seckbach. And you can follow me on Instagram at Elie Seckbach.